Most gracious and heavenly Father, we come before you today seeking your wisdom and your guidance. As we gather for church school, Lord, we ask for open hearts and open minds to receive your teachings. We thank you, Lord, for the gift of fellowship and the opportunity to gather as a community of believers. As we learn and grow together, Lord, allow us to cultivate unity and love amongst one another. Father, we ask that your transformative power be at work in our lives, and as we study your word, help us to apply its teachings daily. Lord, allow the truths we learn in church school shape our thoughts, actions, and deeds, and allow your word to inspire us to grow in faith and love as we leave here equipped to share your light with others. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Greetings, March 17, 2024, as we continue in this third Sunday of this new unit and in this new quarter, righteous and humble actions are defending our faith. 1 Peter 3:18, 8 through 17. Focus is adhering to dominant norms as a safe and convenient way to live. How do we voice objections to these norms without inviting conflict? In 1 Peter, Christians are encouraged to defend their faith through righteous and humble actions, even at the risk of suffering. The goals for the lesson is to comprehend how Christians are to react to suffering and challenges to their faith, to value the challenge that Peter sets forth as a response to suffering for the faith, to defend the faith when facing suffering for Christ, godliness, and thus so the three goals. In verses 8 through 9, we talk about godliness in suffering, a plea of unity and love among God's people. Be of one mind. Most of us are willing to have one mind as long as that one mind is my mind. But the one mind is to be the mind of Christ, as 1 Corinthians 2:16 points out. Our common mind is to be Jesus's mind. This command brings us back to the need to know God's word. We can't be of one mind, the mind of Jesus, if we don't know what Jesus's mind is. The word of God shows us the mind of Jesus. Be of one mind. This speaks to the essential unity of God's people. We are one, but we are not all the same. While we should all be one mind, we can't expect everyone to be like us. God has built both unity and diversity among God's people. It's interesting as we think about this lesson and what's going on today, in that in some circles, there is a trouble. People are troubled, politicians in particular, troubled with this whole idea of diversity and inclusion and equity, DEI. Every cell of our body, however, is different, and each one of us has a role to play. But every cell in your body has this same DNA code written in it, the master plan for the whole body. Every cell in your body has the same mind. We could say that Christian should be like a good choir. Each one sings with one's own voice in some different parts, but everyone sings to the same music and in harmony with one another. Having compassion, tender-hearted, courteous, Peter described the kind of warm love that should be among the people of God. We should be compassionate, brotherly, sisterly, tender-hearted, and even polite. Remember that this was the measure Jesus gave to the world to identify his true disciples. By this, all will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. Jesus did not command us to like our brothers and sisters in Christ, but we are commanded to love them, and once we start loving them, we will start liking them. This lesson is right apropos as I'm preparing for Maundy Thursday service and of this passage of scripture from John 13:35 about loving one another, and this is how they will know that we are Christians. Not returning evil for evil or reveling for reveling, but on the contrary, blessing. The greatest challenge to our love for others comes when we are wronged. At those times, we are called not to return evil for evil, but to give a blessing instead. No dispute, argument, or personality conflict among believers should linger. Even if one Christian gets out of line, the loving response of other Christians should keep the problem small and short-lived. The natural response to hostility is retaliation. This is what the terrible ethnic conflicts all over the world are all about. One group wrongs another and dedicates the rest of their existence in repaying that wrong. Only the love of Jesus for our enemies can break the terrible cycle. Jesus reminded us that it is no great credit if we love those that love us in return. The real test of love is to demonstrate compassion to our enemies. Matthew 5:44-47 in the Great Sermon on the Mount, that you may inherit a blessing. We love one another, but not only for the sake of Jesus, whose body we are members of. We love one another, but not only for the sake of our brother or our sister, for whom Jesus Christ. We also love one another for our own sake. By blessing those who have wronged us, we will inherit a blessing. If you can't love for the sake of Jesus or for the sake of your brother or sister, then do it for your own sake. A quotation from Psalm 34:12-16 demonstrates the blessing that comes to those who turn away from evil and do good. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Doing good is often difficult because, as a general rule, evil is rewarded immediately, and the reward of doing good is often delayed. But the rewards of good are better and far more secure than the rewards of doing evil. God promises this in the passage quoted by Peter. Verses 13-17, how to handle it when your good is returned with evil. And who is he who will harm you? Though Peter says that Christians should always answer evil with good, he also lived in the real world and knew that people often repaid good with a response of evil. Not to be hated by the world, to be loved and flattered and caressed by the world is one most terrible position in which a Christian can find themselves. But bad things have I done, asked the ancient sage, that he should speak well of me. If you become followers of what is good, literally become followers, be zealous. Some Jews were zealots, boasting their zeal for the Lord or his law. All Christians should be zealots for that which is good. But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. Peter reminds us that there is even a blessing for us when we suffer for righteousness' sake. God will care for us, especially when we suffer unjustly. Jesus spoke of the same attitude, and do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul, but rather fear the one who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Matthew 10:28. And do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled. This is what Peter is saying. The presence of possibility of suffering for doing good should not make us shrink back from doing good. Instead, we should give a special place, sanctified to God in our hearts, and always be ready to explain our faith, give a defense, always doing it with the right attitude, meekness, and fear. I love this verse in the scripture, that we should not be afraid of threats and be troubled by it, but we should always be ready to explain and our faith and give a defense, doing it with a right attitude, meekness, and fear. I've had occasions myself to do this, and it really, the whole idea of this last part, with meekness and fear of God, that I don't have to really prove anything to you, but I can do it with meekness and let you know that what I believe, and what I know. Other manuscripts render sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. As sanctifies, Christ is the Lord in your hearts. The simple meaning of the injunction is that as the very center of life, there is to be one Lord, and that is Christ. Other lords are not permitted to invade the sanctuary of our hearts and exercise dominion over us. our own selfish desires, the opinion of others, worldly wisdom, the pressure of circumstances, these and many other lords command us, and we are to turn away. Our simple and complete allegiance should be to the one Lord. We can be ready to give a defense if we have made ourselves ready in knowing the Bible. Peter knew how important it was to give a defense for everyone who asked you. He had to do this in situations described in Acts. Throughout Acts, we see him having to do this. Those who revel your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. Our good conduct, when our good is returned with evil, will prove others wrong in their opinions about us, and it will make them ashamed for speaking against our godly ways. For it is better, if it is the will of God, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. None of us want to suffer, but if we must, may it be for doing good and not for doing evil. Sometimes Christians are obnoxious and offensive and are made to suffer for it. They may wish it for persecution for the sake of the gospel, but really it is simply suffering for doing evil. We're to suffer for doing good, not for doing evil. Righteous and humble actions are defending our faith. This is our lesson. I commend to you the challenges on the next slide. Blessings to you.
Sometimes you wear a smile on your face to disguise that you're in pain, and you feel there is no one who understands. But know that God knew all along. There will be times you won't be strong, so place all of your problems in His hands.